Welcome, I'm Jerry Sabloff, the president of SFI, and it's a delight to see a full house on an evening with much needed rain, but I know that doesn't make it convenient slogging through the parking lot. So thank you so much for coming. I think, as always, we're in for a special treat tonight. Before I introduce our speaker, just a quick reminder of our annual Ulam lectures, which are coming up next month, and on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday night, October 2nd, 3rd, and 4th. We are fortunate to have one of the world's most distinguished biologists, Robert May, who's now Lord May of Oxford. It will be talking on literally three interesting topics: beauty and truth in mathematics and science, what is stability in today's complex financial systems, and people in tomorrow's world, looking at ecological and population issues. So three very different topics, but I'm sure, as have been in recent years, this will be a very exciting event, and I hope you'll be able to join us. Tonight, our speaker is Scott Ortman. We share Scott with the Crow Canyon Archaeological Center up in Cortez, Colorado. He's an Omidyar Fellow here at the Santa Fe Institute and a Lightfoot Fellow at Crow Canyon. He is a terrific Southwest archaeologist in particular, but more generally, and I think we'll get a feeling for that tonight, he's a rare animal in the field of anthropology in that he's interested in all aspects of anthropology. As some of you might know, anthropology actually is consists of four different subfields. One is cultural anthropology, studying living peoples. Second is archaeology, studying peoples in the past. The third is biological anthropology, studying aspects of the physical nature of human beings and our ancestors. And fourthly, linguistics, kind of human languages, both through time and space. If you go to anthropology departments today in academia, you'll often find, in fact, you have four departments rolled into one, and in some universities, these are even splitting up into separate departments. Fewer and fewer anthropology departments teach all of these four really integrated aspects of human nature together. But when looking at Native American peoples, for example, to try to separate out the present from the past, language from other aspects of culture, the physical background through time, is really virtually impossible. And you get these false dichotomies between what archaeologists do, what historians might do, what cultural anthropologists do. And I think what's particularly exciting, and as I say, if this were 40 years ago, I wouldn't say this, but today, quite remarkable about Scott Ortman's work is that he's integrating all four, and particularly linguistics, which tends to get forgotten in many anthropological pursuits today. So we're, I think, in for a treat to hear how this four-field attack on problems of understanding, particularly ancient Puebloan peoples, and especially the Tewa Pueblo, will be quite interesting. Scott is the author of a recent book, Winds from the North. It's a prize-winning book published by the University of Utah Press about Tewa origins and historical anthropology. And for those who want to stay, Scott will be signing copies. They'll be available for purchase, and he'll be signing in the lobby after the talk. So please join me in welcoming Scott Ortman.
Thanks for coming on the rainiest day I can remember in Santa Fe. It's a real honor to see such a nice crowd here tonight. I often find that with many of my colleagues, public lectures trail behind the work that scholars and scientists do, that you don't hear about the things that people are working on until they finish them, publish them, wrap them up in a bow, and they're done. This talk's going to be the opposite of that, largely. I will be talking about some of my published work and giving you a flavor for what I've done so far, but my intention is to take it beyond the work that's in print. Many of the things I'll be talking about tonight are things that I haven't shared with an audience before, so you'll be the first people to hear them. And if they're way off base, you'll be the first people to tell me. So let's get going. I want to start with some of the big questions that I'd like to try and address in the talk tonight. And this is one of the emphases of our community at SFI right now. This is a big one. Does culture matter at the macro level in the history of humanity? There's no shortage of senior scholars who have made a pitch for the role of culture in the broad patterns of why the world of humans is the way it is, why the patterns of cultural diversity are the way they are, why some societies are much larger than others. Here's just a few of the famous and recent books about it. There's a wide range of opinions on this question. I would say the balance of opinion tends to be that if you look at a broad scale, factors of geography and ecology and resources and demography, things like that, tend to matter more and more, and culture tends to matter less and less, at least in the minds of many scholars that have looked at this question. Tonight I'll try to refine this broad question a little bit and say, well, what role did culture play in the evolution of what many archaeologists call social complexity? And this chart here gives you a sense of what archaeologists are talking about when they say the evolution of social complexity. Each dot in the graph there is an archaeological tradition, and they're plotted according to how long ago they occurred, their age on the x-axis, and on the y you can see as a logarithmic scale the size of the largest settlement associated with each tradition as a rough measure of the complexity of the society. So starting about 12,000 years ago, as you can see from the chart, you know, the few bits of data that we have suggest that all human societies were quite small in their organization and in their levels of concentration of people and resources. As time went on from 12,000 years ago to the present, you can see that this envelope of the possible range of complexity of human societies expanded exponentially, such that, you know, before the end, essentially, of the archaeological record in different parts of the world, or the traditional archaeological record, many ancient societies had settlements of in excess of 100,000 people. At the same time, over that entire period, there are many ancient societies that did not become more complex. And this is the crux of the issue, is not only why have some societies increased dramatically in their scale over the past 12,000 years, but why have others remained quite small? Well, folks like Jared Diamond would say, well, you know, this has to do with the intrinsic resources of different areas where people lived, the geographic factors that promoted trade or not, whether there were navigable rivers, coastlines, other things like that. And I don't mean to say tonight that those factors have nothing to do with the broad patterns of human history, but most of the previous work on this topic has tended to treat culture as the residual category. So what many scholars do is they say, well, I can account for this percent of the variation using environment, this percent using demography, this percent using warfare or something else, and well, here's the small percentage that's left over. I'm going to say that must be something about culture that I can't really understand, or I don't really have a good model of, but it must be there, it must have some influence. I don't find that a very satisfactory approach to the problem, because that approach assumes that culture has nothing to do with, you know, the decisions that people have made in articulating with resources and environment and other groups of people. So I'm interested in trying to develop an approach where you can look and find culture in the archaeological record in its own terms. So one of the main questions I want to address tonight is, how could you tell what role culture played in the evolution of complexity in human societies? Well, I haven't really said what culture even is, and I think this is one of the most fundamental problems with this whole endeavor, is that although anthropologists have been writing about culture for a long time, I actually think it's only been quite recently that we've gotten any inklings of what culture is in a real physical sense, in the sense of the the things that go on in our brains that create culture. So to try and address these questions tonight, I'm going to work up from the bottom back to the top. The first thing I will share with you is my thoughts about a view of culture as shared mental models, and especially models that cognitive linguists have labeled conceptual metaphors, and I will explain what those are in just a moment. The second portion of my talk, I will talk about work that I've done to develop methods for, reading the minds of people that created the archaeological record. I'll show you how that's done shortly. The third part of my talk, I will share some thoughts I have about the role of conceptual metaphors in what I would call major transitions in the histories of individual human societies that I've been looking at. I'll give you examples of two particular societies from different parts of the world where major transitions took place, and I think transformations in the metaphoric structures of the people that created these societies played a big role. Finally, I'll wrap up with a hypothesis. I'd like to try and sketch a hypothesis about what role culture plays in the evolution of complexity based on the discussion to that point. Right. So let's begin. This is the foundation of the talk I'm going to give you tonight, and it is a pun intended. As you know, SFI is an interdisciplinary science community, and we hear lots of talks. We go to lots of talks. And as soon as they're over, many of my fellow postdocs and I go into the hall and they say, "What do you think of that talk we just heard?" And some of the things we will say to each other are, "That idea was pretty shaky. That argument was very well designed. Actually, no, I think it was a house of cards. That ought to be rebuilt from the ground up. I don't think it can weather the criticism it will get when it gets published." Et cetera, et cetera. I could probably come up with new phrases along these lines that have never been uttered by a human being before, and you would still be instantly able to interpret what I was saying. And the reason for that is that in our culture, we have internalized a relationship between actual physical buildings and the structure and the process of making intellectual arguments or scientific arguments. So in our culture, arguments are buildings. This is an example of an aspect of human language and thought that is absolutely rampant in everything humans think and do. Cognitive linguists have noticed this, that most of what we say to each other in everyday conversation is literally nonsense, but it is metaphorically coherent. So they have labeled this phenomenon conceptual metaphor, and this is the way people that study this stuff define what conceptual metaphors are. It is the use of the image schematic structure, in other words, the experiential imagery that humans accumulate of a relatively concrete domain of experience to conceptualize and reason about a more abstract domain of experience. And people in this field usually refer to the concrete domain as the source of the metaphor and the abstract domain as the target. These conceptual metaphors are widely shared among groups of people, and they are often used unconsciously. People can become aware of the metaphors that they use in everyday speech, but if you don't pay attention to them, they fly by so fast that you really can't even attend to the fact that you are speaking metaphorically most of the time. They also structure human thoughts and actions in addition to our language. And this is going to be one of the key elements of the approach that I've been developing. What I'm going to show you shortly is that I think you can infer the existence of past conceptual metaphors in the minds of people that created the archaeological record by identifying particular patterns in the material culture of past peoples that are consistent with generalizations that linguists have developed about how humans use figurative speech in everyday life. But another important element of this is that metaphors become embedded in language as what I call semantic fossils. And you can find them through the study of etymology, or polysemy, which is the multiple senses of words, or also patterns of semantic change within a language family. So how can you, before moving on, let me share this with you. The contemporary theory of metaphor was developed by a couple of linguists named George Lakoff and Mark Johnson in a book that they published in 1980 called Metaphors We Lived By. And that book has spawned an incredible industry of researchers who have been investigating conceptual metaphor in human life experimentally. And this is just a sampling of various studies that have been done looking at how humans create and use metaphors in thinking. I don't have time to go through all the details, but it really is quite remarkable, this experimental evidence that conceptual metaphor really is at the core of who we are as humans. What I've done is take the literature on how humans express their metaphors in everyday speech and abstract from that literature six empirical generalizations about how humans do it. These are the six generalizations that come out of that literature. And again, in the interest of moving along, I don't want to focus on the details of this too much, but the point is that each of these patterns becomes the basis in my method of an expectation for patterns in the archaeological record that one can use to test the hypothesis that an apparent relationship you might see in material culture in the past really does reflect the existence of shared mental models, conceptual metaphors, in the minds of the people that created that record in the past. The initial studies that I have done using this approach focused on the material culture of ancestral Pueblo people that lived in the Mesa Verde area of the Southwest. And the first study I did was to address this relationship that archaeologists that work in this area had commented on for a long, long time. You can see these paired images of woven objects and decorated pots, or also cooking pots, from sites of the Mesa Verde tradition. And you can see these intriguing parallels between the use of color, the translation of the textures of woven objects into paint, the design structures, and even specific motifs that you see in various forms of weaving on the pottery. So what I've done is propose that in ancient Mesa Verde culture, the potters shared a metaphor. Pots are textiles. And I investigated whether you can identify patterns in the archaeological record of the pottery painting tradition that are consistent with the ways people express their metaphors in everyday speech. And when I did that, what I found is that indeed you can find patterns reflective of all six of these empirical generalizations about how humans express metaphors in everyday life. Based on this, I think you really can read the minds of people that created the archaeological record. At least some elements. Of course, we can't talk to them directly, but we can at least get some inkling of some of the conceptual structures that conditioned their behavior in the past. I've applied the same approach to other aspects of the material culture of the Mesa Verde area, and what I found is that the people in this society, over time, took this relationship between weaving and pottery and applied it to ever more abstract and larger domains of experience. So on this chart here, what I've got here is a list of various mappings of different kinds of container imagery onto buildings or the landscape or other domains of the experience of people in the past. And then you can see the columns are the dating of archaeological sites. And I've shaded in cells corresponding to when you start to see expressions of these particular metaphors in the material culture of the area. So the first one to be expressed in the area was the actual relationship between basketry and pottery about 600 AD. Pottery and basketry began to be mapped onto the ceremonial structures we know as kivas about 1060 AD. And when loom-based weaving came into the society, that began to be mapped onto pottery as well through a blending process with basketry that is really quite ingenious and interesting to look at. By about 1225, people began to take the imagery of architecture and buildings as a microcosm of the overall world or landscape that they lived in. And finally, by the final few decades of the Mesa Verde tradition, people in that culture were combining imagery of containers and buildings into microcosms of the landscape. So Mesa Verde people hit upon an interesting relationship between weaving and pottery and really ran with it over a period of six centuries. It is quite interesting to see that you can actually map out some details of the development of a conceptual system over time using this method. That's not the only thing you can do once you can reconstruct the metaphors of people in the past using their objects. You can also, it also gives you a new way of relating relating the archaeological record to modern day languages. This is how I did it. I took the metaphoric relationships I found in material culture and looked at modern day Pueblo Indian languages to see if there were etymological traces of those same metaphors embedded in the words of different languages. And what I found is that the entire complex of container metaphors that I found in Mesa Verde material culture are embedded in one particular Pueblo Indian language that's spoken still today, and it's the Tewa language that is spoken in a series of villages just north of Santa Fe. So here's one example. One of the Tewa words for pottery is a compound word that means pottery today, but its etymology involved bringing together the words for earth and clay with the words for baskets. So the literal translation of na'u means earth baskets, but it means pottery today. This implies that when that term was coined, the people that spoke Tewa shared a metaphor in their own culture that linked clay and basketry together in an exact mirror image of the pattern that I found in the material culture of the Mesa Verde area. Another example, the small ceremonial structures that archaeologists call kivas that were parts of the houses of Mesa Verde people began to be decorated in about the 1000s, 1100s AD. And this is one of the most common ways they were decorated, is with these pottery patterns. And if you look at this building, you've got a clay pot below, and above you have a vegetal woven dome-shaped structure that looks sort of like a basket. You have a pot and a basket mirrored against each other to create this image of an emergence place. Well, there's words in the Tewa language that reflect these relationships as well. Here's a series of terms from Tewa that relate emergence places or lakes, which is what Tewa people describe as their place of emergence, kivas, and pots. And here is a term for a pitched roof that is appears in a, I'm sorry, it's cut off a little bit, but I'll just tell you, it goes tufedi, and it means a pitched roof in Tewa today, and it is a compound word that was formed by bringing together the word for basket and the word for sticks or timber and the word for of. In other words, the roof or a pitched roof is a basket made of timbers. That is a word that precisely describes the characteristic cribbed roof of the Mesa Verde style kiva. Third example, the last villages created by Mesa Verde people in the 13th century AD were generally roundish. They were built in these concave geographical environments, generally with springs or water sources in the center. The houses of these villages faced inward and terraced down toward the center. Also, some villages have these large plazas in them that are roundish. They appear to be expressing some of this container or bowl imagery as well. And the picture actually is of another village site where you can kind of see the rubble on the rim of the canyon there and the spring marked by the cottonwood tree. Well, one of the Tewa words for a village actually derives from an older word for a pottery bowl. And it also today means a large, low, roundish place or a plaza. So at some point in the past, people that spoke the Tewa language took a word that meant bowl and added additional meanings to it to refer to bowl-shaped geographical environments and villages and plazas. What's incredibly interesting about this is that Tewa villages in the area where they live today are not bowl-shaped. They're not roundish. They're not built in these concave geographic environments. They are flat and rectilinear. So it's hard to imagine how the Tewa language could have had words that had this history if the language had always been spoken in New Mexico where it's spoken today. These kinds of studies suggest to me that the Tewa language actually originated in the Four Corners and was spoken in the Mesa Verde tradition, and that the speakers of that language migrated to New Mexico in the late 1200s. So these studies of metaphors embedded in language form just one element of of the book that I recently finished that presents a range of studies, including studies of human biology, oral tradition, historical linguistics, and also ethnography, to make the case or to better identify the relationship between the ancestral Pueblo society of the Mesa Verde area and contemporary Tewa people. And it's a fascinating story and an interesting archaeological problem and an archaeological debate that is still going on. I don't want to focus on that tonight because, frankly, you can read the book. It's available in the lobby if you're interested, and I would be happy to sign copies for you after the talk if you'd like. What I want to do now is turn to the following question. Well, fair enough, maybe you can find traces of metaphors in the decoration of pots or the form of buildings or the style of a kiva. Does that make a big difference in the big picture of what happened in Pueblo society in the past? I think that it does help us understand it better, but it takes a little while to be able to see it. But what I'm going to do tonight is give you two examples of societies that have gone through what I would call major transitions and illustrate the role that changing conceptual structures and especially metaphors played in these transformations. So here is an example, one line of evidence of the transformation that occurred in the Southwest when ancestral Pueblo people left the Mesa Verde area in the late 1200s and left villages that looked like this, that were probably called bu or bowls, and moved into villages that look like this. Big, rectilinear, plaza-focused villages with very, very different architecture. I've already mentioned that these villages up in the north were probably referred to using this word for a pottery bowl. What were these new villages referred to? Well, they definitely don't look like pots anymore. Were they still referred to using the same word? I don't think so. But I think the best way to introduce what the change that occurred is to look at how contemporary Tewa people talk about the communities in which they live in the songs that they compose for the dances that they hold during the year. So here's a song, the lyrics of a song in translation from a Tewa ceremony that was published in a study by Jill Sweet. In San Juan Pueblo, right in the middle of the plaza outside the kiva here, white corn goddess stands. With her living plants, she stands prepared at dawn. What the song does is it presents San Juan Pueblo and the plaza as a place where the corn is growing, where the corn goddess is standing prepared. Here's another example. At Soul Village over there where the rivers join at Confluence Lake, they come right here carrying flowers. The Ohua have flowers there. The Ohua are the cloud beings. They come to see our fields. And the flowers, by the way, are cloud flowers. Ohua povi. Cloud flowers representing the thunderheads of thunderstorms. Here again, what you see is the village presented as a field where the clouds come to fertilize the corn maidens and bring new life. What these and other songs are expressing is an image of the contemporary Tewa community as being a garden, where the women are corn and the men are clouds. And the term that is up at the top there that I hope you can read, I'll say it for you, that Tewa people use to describe these places today is Owinge, as in Oke Owinge, which is the name of one of the pueblos. The term has nothing to do with pottery vessels, but it does incorporate a term that has to do with growing upright. For example, the verb Owing refers to growing in an upright position. And it's a term that's used to describe the corn plants growing in a garden. So Owinge, probably a good translation of it would be something like, they're growing upright. Bigger things than corn growing upright. Instead of Owinge, it would be Owinge. So these songs present the village and the community as being like a garden, not like a pottery vessel. Here's one more example. Ready we stand in San Juan town, our corn maidens and corn youths, or corn mothers and corn fathers. Now bring your misty water and throw it different ways. Then likewise, throw your misty water towards San Juan. Many that you are, pour water over our corn maidens' ears. Again, the imagery here is of water as a male force combining with corn as a female force to produce new life. The community is a garden. Well, it looks as though Tewa people have been imagining their communities this way from the time they moved into the Tewa Basin where they live today. And there's a few reasons why I think that. One is that ancestral sites that have been vacated since about the early 1300s AD are known still today as being Owinkeyi, or village ruins, or their standing or their growing ruins. And this is a list of the ancestral villages that I've been able to identify. I've mapped them out on the ground here using the white symbols that you see on the map. Another reason I think that Owinge reflects the way Tewa people have been thinking about their communities from the early 1300s is that you can see a lot of blending of architectural and agricultural imagery in the archaeological record of the Tewa area. This is just one example. It's a constructed field where an ancient farmer used stone cobbles to outline little grid cells where corn would be grown. And you can see from the picture here that the plants actually do grow better in these fields than they grow outside of them. This is the inside. There's a gravel mulch covering the ground that helps the plants to grow better as opposed to this area. You can see an example of one of the more robust constructed fields up there in the figure. In the early 20th century, archaeologists that first encountered features like this saw these and interpreted them as the foundations of houses because they had the same exact dimensions as the rooms of other houses that they found in ruins that were being excavated. So they interpreted these as villages where all the adobe had weathered away for some reason. Now, it didn't make them scratch their heads that there were hardly any artifacts here, and of course a village of some 50 rooms would have a whole lot of potsherds laying around. But it turns out that they're not villages, they are gardens, but these are gardens that express a lot of the architectural imagery that you see in actual dwellings. The idea appears to be that in the same way that people grow in houses, corn grows in these gardens. One of the details of these constructed fields that's interesting is that in the corners of the fields, you often will see an upright stone marking the corners of the fields. You find these marking the corners of house foundations and actual sites as well. This is an example of my friend and collaborator, Porter Swensel, pointing to an upright stone that he refers to as a corn-raising stone, even though it occurs in the corner of the foundation of a house. People and corn are basically the same thing in Tewa culture. Another example of this blending of architectural and agricultural imagery is that many old, early small dwellings were reused as gardens. They actually were leveled, the stones picked up and turned into grid cells, and then they were actually planted with corn. In other words, people planted corn in old houses. It may not be coincidence that Tewa people tended to bury children that were unfortunate enough to die very young under the floors of their houses as well. People are corn. And this is archaeological material that dates to the 1300s and 1400s AD. So I think this relationship between architecture and agriculture, or between gardens and villages, has been structuring Tewa society for some time. So when Mesa Verde society collapsed and its people moved to the Tewa area where they still live today, what seems to have happened is that a worldview based on container imagery was transformed into one that was based on agricultural imagery. This is just one of many changes that occurred when Tewa society formed in the Rio Grande. What I'm going to do here very briefly is show you some patterns in the archaeological record that reflect how remarkable this transformation was. What I have here are distributions of corn grinding complexes that reflect the number of mealing bins found together in one spot in sites of the Mesa Verde area and in the Tewa area. And what you can see is that in the old homeland in the north, there are quite a few fairly large grinding complexes that were probably used by groups of four and five women simultaneously to prepare food. It implies that the households of the Mesa Verde area were sometimes quite large and much larger than they were in the Rio Grande area. The ratio of the rooms to the kivas in these sites changed dramatically. Above, you can see that the typical ratio is before the migration was about 6 to 10 rooms per kiva. After the migration, notice this is a logarithmic scale, so the typical ratio is about 100 rooms per kiva. Order of magnitude change in the relationship between ceremonial structures and people. I suspect this is an expression of the emergence of much larger cooperative ritual groups in Tewa society. After the migration, some of the villages grew to be much larger, 4 to 5 times larger than any villages that Pueblo people had ever lived in before in the Mesa Verde area, from a high of maybe 800 people to about almost 3,000 people. These villages were inhabited for longer. You can see that the distribution of the occupation spans of villages shifted up toward more years of continuous occupation after this period of migration. There's evidence for increasing rates of exchange in ancient Pueblo ancient Tewa society. What you can see here is the frequency of imported glazeware pottery in sites at a given distance traveling from south to north away from the production area of those kinds of pots. And right after the migration, you see a fall-off pattern that looks like this. 100 years later, you see a much more gradual fall-off pattern. In other words, glaze-painted pottery was diffusing more readily across this landscape about a couple hundred years after this period of migration than it had before. Finally, you can use the ratio of decorated pottery to cooking pottery or utility pottery to look at what I think is a good index of the overall, I would say, economic growth of the society. The blue line represents the history of Mesa Verde society that was quite jaggedy and fairly unstable. It did grow, but it was not terribly stable. And the red line represents what happened in the Tewa Basin after this period of migration. And it initially wasn't so great, but as time went on, the economy appears to have really taken off. And the reasoning here is that decorated pottery reflects people having the free energy to put some more of their energy into their pots. So the higher the ratio of decorated pottery to utility ware that they would have to have for everyday life or for everyday cooking, the more wealth they had in their society. So a whole lot of really interesting things happened. A real significant change in the scale and productivity and, I would say, wealth of Pueblo society took place as a result of this period of migration and this period of pronounced change in metaphoric structures. Yet all of this happened in a relatively similar environment, at least as measured by the productivity of beans and corn in historic farming yield data from the two areas the Mesa Verde area and especially the area around Los Alamos. So what role did this play in all of those changes that occurred? So far, all I've shown you is that there's a correlation there. Is there a way to get a little bit farther along and suggest that there's a causal connection between changing metaphoric structures and all of those other interesting changes in the society? At this point, I wouldn't say that you could prove that there is a causal connection, but I think you could at least lay out a hypothesis that there was. And to get there, I want to turn to one other interesting correspondence between farming and villages that you can see in the archaeological record. This is an example of a river valley with an ancestral site, and all those little squares represent the agricultural features that have been roughly sketched on this map. Now, these aren't exactly the scale, but at least it gives you a sense of the widespread distribution of the farming features and fields that were surrounding these Tewa villages. You can see a map of what the village looks like here and the topography of it. Up at the top, what I've done is list the sizes of these farming areas from various surveys that have been done in the Tewa area. And what you can see is that most of them are quite small, around a tenth of a hectare or less, no matter how you tabulate them. But the typical adult would have needed to cultivate at least half a hectare to provide enough food to feed themselves. What this implies is that the average Tewa farmer in the past planted corn in many different places on this landscape, not just in one spot. They probably, based on the ethnographic literature, planted different colors of corn in different garden plots, in different microenvironments, in an attempt to hedge their bets against the kind of weather year they were going to have, and to, in a sense, have a form of insurance against unpredictable rainfall. Well, I think one could think about that experience as contributing to the model of the Tewa economy that developed after this period of migration. You can see here three ancestral villages. I hope you can, in this Google Earth image, the outlines of the adobe mounds. Think of those as those garden plots. In the same way that a farmer in the past would have planted corn in many different locations and then harvested it and shared it with his family, I think you can imagine Tewa people sharing their production in each house with inhabitants of adjacent villages. So this is the way I could imagine it working. In a world where people are corn and villages are gardens, the basic unit of economic self-sufficiency appears to have no longer been kin-based, based on the corn grinding data I showed you. But the positive emotions associated with the rain and the conjugal union that I showed you in those songs probably promoted trust among non-relatives, people who weren't related to each other, within villages and also between villages. My suggestion to you is that these metaphorical structures helped to create an environment that supported new levels of specialization, exchange, and regional integration. The idea here is that before a person can decide not to produce all of the things that they need to live, they need to be confident that they are going to be able to get them from someone else. And one of the things you need to do to become confident you can do that is to trust other people. And the more people you trust in your world, the more confident you will be that you'll be able to get what you need, and the more likely you might be to specialize and take advantage of economies of scale and production, let's say. Now, this is just a hypothesis. I'm not saying that we know this is what happened, but this is an attempt to lay out how changing metaphoric structures might have encouraged the development of a larger scale, a more integrated Tewa society. I'll turn to a second example now that I am just starting to work on that I haven't talked to any audience about before, but it is a study I'm doing now of Uruk period Mesopotamia. Some of you that know this area know that the world's first city and the earliest writing, the first invention of writing in the history of humanity occurred in the late Uruk period in southern Mesopotamia, about 3300 BC. During this period of time, researchers that work in this area talk about an Uruk takeoff, where the settlement of Uruk that in the early and middle Uruk period was a little bit less than 100 hectares, suddenly expanded to be more than 250 hectares probably the largest single settlement anywhere on the earth at that time. Here's a map of the city of Uruk during the late Uruk period. These circles represent 5-minute walking distances within the settlement. Here's the central area, and you can see the concentration of public and administrative buildings and temples that grew up there. This really was the world's first city. How did it happen? How did it come to be? There was definitely social stratification in ancient Uruk society. This is an image of it from a very famous vase called the Warka vase. It was in the Iraqi National Museum, and some of you may have heard of this. It was stolen from the Iraqi National Museum after the fall of Saddam Hussein, and it somehow miraculously reappeared and is now back in the museum. But here's an image of the social structure of Uruk society with the domestic animals and plants underneath, and then a stratum of commoners, no clothing, no hair even, carrying loads of foodstuffs. And then at the top of the society is this bearded figure with the long skirt, who's sometimes referred to as being the En, or a version of the one of the world's first kings. This person is often represented in Uruk art as the spouse of Inanna, who is the goddess, patron goddess of Uruk. And you can see those staff-like objects are the insignia of the city of Uruk up there at the top. What were the metaphors of social stratification in ancient Uruk? It appears that the imagery of shepherding was one of the key metaphors that helped to produce social stratification. What you see here are some seal imagery from either stamp seals that were used to sign administrative documents from the pre-Uruk period up here on the upper left, and then some roll-out cylinder seals that date from the later Uruk period. And in the early Uruk period, or the Ubaid period, which predates all of this, what you see is a central figure with this long skirt that mixes together domestic animal imagery, either a pig or some kind of a goat or sheep, and a human. And they are depicted as controlling wild nature in various forms. Afterwards, in the Uruk period, when the Uruk takeoff took place, you begin to see these kinds of imagery where you have this bearded figure with the skirt who is feeding the flocks, provisioning the flocks of domestic animals. And you can see again the insignia of the city of Uruk there in this rollout cylinder. The imagery of shepherding was not only seen in art, but it was actually embedded in the administrative structures of ancient Uruk. What I have here on the right is a picture of a early clay tablet with proto-cuneiform writing on it that presents, it's basically a tax receipt that presents an accounting of a herd of pigs that was distributed to several different temple households. And the way these accounts work is this is 60, this is 10, 20, 30, so that's 90, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 95 pigs divided into two groups, one group of 11 that was treated this way, and another group of 60, 70, 80, 1, 2, 3, 4. 84 and 11 adds up to 95. The 84 treated in this other way as reflected in this symbol. And then these two groups were distributed again across three different temple households is the way the scholars that work with this material interpret these symbols here. Well, it turns out that the exact same accounting practices and principles that were used to manage the flocks of the temples in Uruk were used to manage the slaves. This is an account of a group of 8 slaves. The counting is up there, 8, and this is the symbol for slaves. This is the person that owned them. There were 3 males and 5 females, and of the 5 females, 4 were adults, and 1 was a child. Of the males, 1 was an adult, and 2 were children. The exact same techniques used to manage Flocks of domestic animals were used to manage the flocks of the slaves and other attached laborers that created the temples and palaces of Uruk. You see the same symbols used in the accounts of laborers and animals in many other ways. For example, here you have this symbol here that's used to describe a young animal, and it's used to describe young humans in the tablet over there to the right. Finally, somewhat later in time, during the early dynastic period, when literature actually began to appear in actual cuneiform texts on tablets, shepherding imagery related to political authority and cities and the life of city-states is rampant. And these are just a few examples that I found from looking at some of these texts in translation. So the king is referred to as the leading herdsman of all who have breath. Enlil, the primary god of the ancient Sumerians, is described as the bright-eyed, the shepherd who decrees the fates. Inanna, the patron goddess of Uruk, has taken charge of the crook staff and wand of shepherdship, that is the insignia of the city of Uruk. Here's another wonderful poem related to religious life. My God, you who are my father who begot me, lift up my face like an innocent cow in pity. How long will you neglect me? Leave me unprotected like an ox. Leave me without guidance. What you can see here is the author taking the perspective of a helpless domestic animal in the face of the Lord and saying, please protect me. I can't live without you. Finally, here's a wonderful poem that illustrates the connections between shepherding and civilization in Uruk. Without Enlil, the great mountain, the great god, no cities would be built, no settlements founded, no stalls would be built, no sheepfolds established. You see the parallelism there between the architecture of shepherding and the architecture of cities. No king would be raised, no high priest would be born, no ma priest, no high priestess would be chosen by sheep omen. The workers would have neither controller nor supervisor. Without the shepherd, the sheep wouldn't know what to do. They would run randomly around. They'd be disorganized. And as a result, the rivers, the floodwaters, would not bring overflow. And in field and meadow, the rich grain would fail to flower. In other words, the world would be pretty awful without the shepherd to guide the commoners. So in ancient Uruk, it appears that these metaphors related to shepherding were a part of many aspects of social and political life during the period of the world's first cities and the first writing. And the way it appears to have worked is that care of the domestic herds became a model for the relationship between elites and commoners. And of course, the role of the domestic animals was to obey their masters, and the role of the masters was to provide and to protect the domestic animals or the commoners. And the resulting organization enabled a new scale of economic production and political integration. Now, I don't want to say that was a good thing for most people. It probably wasn't. But it clearly did allow more people to participate in the system of the city-state of Uruk and to live in a relatively small area. So I think one has to say that these new metaphoric structures were probably related to the formation of the world's first cities. So I'd like to briefly wrap up now and try to pull this together and say, all right, you can see these correlations between metaphoric transformations and these qualitative changes in the scale, integration, and differentiation, the complexity of human societies. How might these metaphors actually have encouraged those kinds of changes to take place? To discuss this, I want to take a step back for a second and talk about the work of a neuroscientist named Antonio Damasio, who has a very famous book called Descartes' Error that describes his work with brain damaged patients, describing the deficits that they have in everyday reasoning based on where the brain damage has occurred. And he's developed a model about how humans think that he labels somatic marking, and this is how it works. Humans, in their daily life, having their experience, let's say you're walking down the street and you step down to pick up a sharp knife and the knife cuts you. You will have an automatic reaction to that experience. Your heart rate will go up, You'll have a startle reaction. You'll be a little bit fearful. Your eyes will dilate. Your skin temperature will heat up, etc. These are called primary emotions. These are automatic responses to experience. Hunger is a primary emotion. Fear, anxiety, other things like that. They just happen. They're not. You have no control over them. They are evolutionarily ancient. They are hardwired in us. But when you, in your daily experience, when you have these emotional reactions to things that happen to you, your mind, your brain creates images of your body experiencing that emotion. So if you are hungry in a certain experience, let's say you go on a hike and you forget to bring your lunch, and about 3 in the afternoon you're really hungry and you're not sure if you're going to make it back to camp to get any food, your brain stores a trace of the memory of your body state being hungry as well as going on the hike. So these are what Damasio calls secondary emotions. They're images of the body states associated with these primary emotions. And these secondary emotions become an element of the overall body experiences of humans. Well, in Damasio's view, reasoning, the way reasoning works is that when people are presented with a decision, what they do is they check in with their store of accumulated experience, and they check in with the secondary emotions that are associated with the imagery of possible outcomes of taking one course of action or another. So when people make decisions, according to Damasio, what they do is they weigh different alternatives based on the emotional correlates in their experience of taking path A, B, or C, or action A, B, and C. I think this potentially provides the link between the world of metaphor and the world of society. Here's the key. Our experiences, including the secondary emotions that go along with them, become the source domains for metaphors. As I said before, metaphors take our bodily experience of concrete realms of life and map them onto more abstract domains. The emotional experiences that go along with our bodies go right along with them. So these metaphors encourage the transfer of all the source domain imagery to the target domain, not just the physical stuff, but also the bodily and emotional stuff that goes along with it. And as a result, metaphors encourage people to behave in ways that are consistent with those emotional correlates. So if you've had the experience of picking up a knife and you know that it cuts and it hurts and you don't like it and you don't want to do it, if a politician tells you something like, Germany forced Greece to cut public services to the bone, you would say, oh, that must be a bad thing. The natural logic of the body kicks in and tells you that was a bad thing for Germany to do. Bad Germany. Now, of course, politicians could frame the situation in a totally different way, using different metaphors that would make you respond, thank God Germany finally did that. Right? And this is what politics is all about. But think about what happens when the metaphors are not in competition, and they're unconscious, and they are widely shared in the community, and people aren't even aware of the fact that that's what they're thinking in terms of. The emotional correlates of those metaphors structure people's behaviors in very powerful ways. So, in my view, coordinated behavior in society emerges from individuals that behave in terms of the emotional correlates of their shared social metaphors. Finally, now, we can wrap up with an image of how, or a hypothesis about how, metaphors relate to the evolution of social complexity in humans. The first point I want to make about this is that there are economies and returns to scale that are inherent in the world, and many of my colleagues at the Santa Fe Institute have been studying this and have shown that whether you're talking about biological species or human societies or even stars, there are economies of scale and returns to scale in the universe. They're there. They're always there. But for humans to realize them, they need to coordinate their behavior. A Hobbesian war of all against all is not going to create a city. People have to put constraints on their behavior and behave in certain ways, in certain coordinated ways, for human societies to be able to realize these economies of scale. Now, social coordination, as in the case of ancient Uruk, it's not necessarily good for each individual person in the society, but it is often good for the group. And I think this is the nexus of much of the to and fro of political debate in many societies, is about what's good for individuals versus what's good for the group. They're definitely in conflict in human societies. They always are. And this is why, because the economies and returns are there, but they're not always good for individuals. Let me finish with a metaphor about metaphor. There are other social species out there on the earth, and some of the most incredible ones are the social insects, you know, ant colonies, beehives, etc. Most of the, you know, these ants do incredible things by giving up a lot of their individual freedom evolutionarily in the service of the queen. And the way they achieve coordinated behavior is through chemical signaling. In other words, the ants release pheromones when they find food along the path, and other people find it, and they say, ooh, I like following that trail. Right? Because the pheromones induce, according to the research, the pheromones induce hormonal changes in the ants that encourage them to behave in certain ways that benefit the group, sometimes more so than themselves. Even like the larvae in the ant colony emit a secretion that induces hormonal changes in the worker ants that lead them to want to take care of the larvae. Okay, in ants, this is all of a chemical process driven by genetic evolution. In humans, what I would suggest is that the emotional correlates of the source domains of our metaphors do the same thing. In other words, by connecting to our automatic emotional reactions to our experiences, they induce actually biochemical changes in us that encourage us to behave in ways that are consistent with the entailments or the expectations of our metaphors. Now, I don't mean to say that we are slaves to our metaphors. People can become aware of them and they can change them, and human societies have many times. But I also think that metaphors play a much larger role in the evolution of human culture than many of my colleagues in social science today give it credit for doing. So for me, the next steps are to try to articulate this view as cleanly as I can, and then try to think about ways to developing a method of testing whether these relationships really are causal. With that, I will briefly thank the various outfits that have supported me over the years, and I can take your questions. Thank you. Yes. So there were two questions there. The first one was about the connections between what I'm talking about and Joseph Campbell's ideas about archetypes.
Living myths,
I'm sorry. Absolutely, you know, stories and myths become source domains of metaphors as well. One of the interesting studies that I've come across suggests that when subjects are primed with historical references to events in the past, they tend to use those references in interpreting ambiguous statements that follow. In other words, you know, I mean, George Bush described 9/11 as this generation's Pearl Harbor, for example, you know, in an attempt to encourage the U.S. population to view this as an act of war as opposed to something else. So that definitely, I'm in agreement there. Your second question was about whether there's a level of abstraction that occurs before the process of mapping concrete to abstract. And could you elaborate a little bit more on that, because I'm not quite following you.
For example, if you make a metaphor of knife cutting, before picking that knife as a source for the metaphor, you might have, say, emotional problems already existing from previous experience, so you have a
I see. Right, right. So I think your question is in a sense about where experience begins. And to some extent, I do think that some of the source domains that we use in metaphors are hardwired in us. I think they're a product of our evolutionary history, and humans become aware of them, you know, intrinsically. I think I couldn't say that I know exactly which ones are, but I think that they're there. I also think there have been studies that look at how universal metaphors are versus culturally specific. And for example, in every society that's been studied, more is up, and light is good and dark is bad. And in every society that I know of, anger is conceptualized in terms of heat. So there are some metaphors that, in a sense, are more natural than others, I think, because they relate more directly to our primary experience. And then there are other metaphors that are a bit more elaborate and are more culturally specific. Of course, the ones based on technologies like pots or particular ways of farming or shepherding, you know, you can't have those metaphors if you don't have prior experience of those domains to begin with. In the back. The process of how societies transform their metaphors is a messy one. I get into this quite a bit in the book. I didn't dwell on it today, but I guess to cut to the chase, I think in the case of the collapse of Mesa Verde society and the migration to the Rio Grande, I think it's not unreasonable to couch it as being a revolution. And that's the way the oral traditions of the Pueblos seem to present it. There's a whole other area of research about how social movements get going and what it takes for a society to reach a tipping point where that transformation takes place. And those are good things to study next. I'm not there yet. Yes, in the front. Mm-hmm. Well, the Lord is my shepherd is still with us. Yeah, the question is about the extent to which it's fair to think about ancient societies as having a couple of metaphors that are so widely shared that everyone is, in a sense, behaving very harmoniously in terms of those concepts. And, of course, the answer is no. In every society, there are competing metaphors competing for attention, I would say, or competing for followers, you might say, from the selfish metaphor view, perhaps, to riff off of Richard Dawkins. There's a huge area there to understand what is it that encourages certain metaphors to spread and acceptance in the society and others to wane. And I wouldn't claim to have any understanding of that. It's a great thing to study, and obviously a very relevant thing to study, because even in our own society today, there are very different images of what our society should be like that are flying around in different people, and they're in competition. All right. Thanks very much for your attention. There are books in the back if you'd like some.